Thanks so much for the invitation to come here. So my background is in industry, and I've come into academia 5 or so years ago as a practice-based researcher. I now run the DCRC at the University of the West of England, and I'm part of the research group there that we call IDOCS, along with Judith Aston, Sandra Gaudenzi, and others, associates. We hold a biannual symposium now. We have a website and a thriving Facebook community which brings together practitioners and scholars are thinking about the transformative potential of interactive documentary, the practice and its meaning for society. So I'll be drawing on documentary and digital cultural studies in this talk, thinking about forms of participation emerging within documentary that I think are transformative for subjects of documentary and audiences alike. I'll be talking about how participatory practices that were at the margins during the 20th century have come to the fore in the context of digital documentary. Within a history marked by an interplay between technology and cultural form, I'll outline how the openness of computerisation has allowed producers to devise new types of participation within documentary production processes and afforded non-linear and interactive forms, but how that same openness produces a context where collaboration and exploitation are twin potentialities. There's a tension intended within the title, producing participation, between the act of producing, manufacture, control, which is a process of making, devising, controlling, implying oversight, and the voluntary act of the participant. And this tension necessarily runs through any discussion of documentary participation. I'll suggest that participation within complex media making can't be thought about without an acknowledgement of mediation, both technological and human. And I find co-creation to be a concept that we need in the frame in order to describe and seek to understand what is at play between the various human and non-human actors in participatory and interactive documentary projects. So my talk is going to move, well, I guess I responded to the invitation to come here by thinking, oh, perhaps I'll do one of those kind of overview type presentations. It seems like for keynotes, people either kind of try out something new or perhaps do a kind of, here's a look back, and I'm trying that. And I thought it might be interesting to try moving between a kind of contextualization analysis of the field and some autobiographical reflections on my involvement over the years with documentary participation. So we'll see how that feels, saying that stuff aloud. So I just wanted to say that I've written and thought about these matters with Professor John Dovey, a colleague at the DCRC, who welcomed me to the Research Centre back in 2009, and I would like to acknowledge his influence in what follows. So why does documentary participation matter? Thinking about such big questions about documentary, you can do no better than look to Bill Nichols, the leading living scholar of the documentary field and kind of taxonomist of the field, the person who tries to sort of see what's the kind of big themes that are going on in the field. So I'll give you a moment to read this quote. So I see him here pointing up the layers within documentary's social and political role, its distinctive contribution to the public sphere. The way that documentary can describe our collective experience, what Bill Nichols elsewhere calls, defines documentary as storytelling about our shared world. But that it's not just a matter of that storytelling reflecting our experience, that storytelling also plays a significant part in structuring our social reality. So widening participation in documentary can allow new stories to be told, can deepen the richness with which they're told, but even more so, that documentary storytelling plays a part in structuring our shared world. So beginning in a way with some history, some kind of prehistory to digital, some countercurrents within 20th century documentary. So while there were distinctive new things going on in documentary participation, the idea, the kind of issues in participation is not wholly new. 20th century documentary was a professional world in which there was little potential for participation in production. Production and exhibition equipment were specialised, bulky, and expensive. There were film formats for amateurs, 8mm, Super 8, later High 8 video. But while amateurs shot footage, which they shared in private with family and friends, an exclusive cadre of documentary professionals observed and interpreted the world on our behalf, shaping footage into real-life stories that circulated in the public sphere. Yet the germs of today's participation, I'd argue, could be found in the early years of documentary. The story might be said to begin in Britain in 1935. That year, Ruby Grierson, whose brother John had coined the term documentary a decade earlier, was working as an assistant on a film that became Housing Problems, about living conditions in London's East End. It was one of the first documentaries to use sync sound. In an incident related by Grierson to his biographer, Ruby Grierson invited the slum dwellers to break the fourth wall and tell their stories directly to their audience. Metaphorically handing over the recording equipment, she urged them to take the opportunity to state their case to those in power. The camera is yours, the microphone is yours, now tell the bastards exactly what it's like to live in the slums. They took up her invitation, and the EastEnders' direct, albeit self-conscious, testimonies are still affecting today. This anecdote became legendary, and I'd suggest it became legendary because it represented a startling alternative to that which became the norm, both in terms of gender, Ruby Grierson, the production assistant, asserting herself, but also because it suggested the possibility of a shared authority between the maker and the documentary subject, this kind of nascent possibility of participation on, if not equal, on shared terms. And even looking back further to 1922, when Robert Flaherty was in the Arctic making Nanook of the North, he went then to great lengths so that the rushes that he shot could be processed on location. And he said about that, "It's always been most important for me to see the rushes. But another reason for developing the film in the North was to project it to the Eskimos so that they would accept and understand what I was doing and work together with me as partners." Setting a pattern that was to become the standard in social documentary, this partnership that Flaherty suggested was on his terms and ended with the shoot, the subjects having no involvement or leverage on the meaning-making process of the editing. "This is the world as I see it," we could say was the position of most 20th century documentary. But that auteur position wasn't uncontested. The idea of the documentary subject's rights surfaced notably alongside political movement through which those excluded from power have fought to have their voices heard. In Paris 68, amidst the student and workers' protests, unrest, film was seen as a central arena of the struggle, a struggle in which the struggle was seen to be against capitalism, consumerism, and traditional institutions, and film and representation was seen as part of the issue. Technicians and film resources were put at the disposal of protesters, and Renault workers produced a film during that time. Across the Atlantic, in the context of civil rights, feminism, Native American rights, some Canadian documentarians began to experiment with media as a tool to support local community in what came to be called the FOGO process. On some islands off the mainland, of Canadian mainland, where fishing was, the fishermen who lived predominantly, the industry there was predominantly fishing, and if people were beginning to leave the islands, that kind of work was falling apart. This process of recording, sharing testimonies between people in remote and spread out areas, and taking their testimony to government, is seen as playing an important role in the fact there are people still living and working on those islands today. So the FOGO process was the first project from the National Film Board of Canada within what became known as Challenge for Change. And in 68, so that began in 67, in 68, a model of media access was pioneered, also in the National Film Board, when George Stoney, who was then director of the Challenge for Change project, agreed a proposal from his team to hand cameras over to Native Americans who were protesting customs charges on a bridge across their land. And this film, the film that they made then, was called You're on Indian Land, available on YouTube. Inspired by You Are on Indian Land and the Challenge for Change output that followed it, forms of access media were then developed in North America and in the UK during the 1970s and beyond. There are other currents at play in this story. The French ethnographic filmmaker Jean Rouche had been developing a practice since the 1950s to express his understanding of documentary as a collaborative, emergent undertaking between producer and subjects. From the mid-50s, he built an extraordinary body of work in West Africa in a process he called shared anthropology. This is Rouche in the 50s, and on the right, his very controversial mid-50s film, Les Maîtres Fous, The Mad Masters, where he filmed kind of weekend rituals where people would enact the roles of the colonial masters, and this was mixed with kind of traditional rituals and trance, and it was considered extremely inflammatory when it was first made, because you see people kind of frothing at the mouth, and you know, it was seen by some as a kind of really kind of retrograde depiction of native peoples. But in that film, and in a number of works that followed, what Rouche did was he would film some material and then sit with the people who were in that material, recording their commentary. So this is kind of that notion of the shared anthropology, the shared process, where you know, the understanding he then presents to the audience of what's going on comes from the people within that footage. So Rouche, that's another one of the films. He made this one kind of hog. This is from Jaguar, which he began in the mid-50s, didn't finish till the mid-60s, which depicts the journey of one of those young men from the country to the Gold Coast. Some of these films, yeah, they kind of mix facts and fiction. So Rouche's explicit purpose was to transform anthropology, what he called the eldest daughter of colonialism. While different disciplines, different contexts, you know, there are some reverberations there for documentary, particularly documentary where it has been a practice looking at those who are you know, socially disadvantaged or lacking in power, when there's been a strong disparity between filmmaker and subject. In 1960, Rouche came back to Paris and, in one of the first uses of mobile sync sound technology, produced an experimental film that tried to capture what was going on in Paris at that time. And I think it's time I showed a clip. And I will show this clip, which reflects a little bit of that film. And actually, it comes from a longer documentary which I made some years later. So there's a voiceover, which is the voiceover from the documentary, and it goes.
The camera's catalyst has its own history. In 1960, the sociologist Edgar Morin proposed to anthropologist Jean Rouche that they may...
Oh, you need the subtitle, so I'm trying to get rid of that little... Oh, I know what I need to do. Sorry. Try again. Come back. Sorry? Yeah. Is somebody speaking to me?
It's okay. Go ahead.
I know, I just... Oh, it's there. Drag it. You're saying drag it back. Drag it back. I just couldn't see the little button. Okay.
The camera as catalyst has its own history. In 1960, the sociologist Edgar Morin proposed to anthropologist Jean Rouch that they make a film looking at the tribe of people living in Paris.
Ce film n'a pas été vécu par des hommes et des femmes qui ont donné des moments de leur existence à une expérience nouvelle de cinéma vérité.
I decided to consider my concitoyens as people that you can study as you do it in anthropology, was I thought a wonderful idea.
Pour un moment, l'idée de réunir des gens sur une table est une excellente idée. Seulement, je ne sais pas si nous arriverons à enregistrer une conversation aussi normale que le serait s'il n'y avait pas de caméra.
We decided to make a film without any script, without any scenario. The only idea would be what is your life? The question would be, are you happy? Êtes-vous heureux?
Monsieur, s'il vous plaît, êtes-vous heureux? Je dis, qu'est-ce que ça peut vous foutre? S'il vous plaît, êtes-vous heureux? N'ayez pas peur, on ne veut pas vous faire de mal.
Roger Morin's film is an altogether different kind of documentary. Not a story of what might have happened if the camera hadn't been there, but a story of what happens because the camera is there.
It was a kind of research in which the human beings, the people we film, were not objects, they were subjects of the film, they were human beings.
My Mac seems to be just kind of giving, just sort of teasing me a bit. He knows you're all here.
Doesn't
Thank
want
you.
To participate.
Exactly. Il ne participe pas. So, okay. So, arriving in London from college in 1978, I became involved in film, feminism, New Left politics. I joined the Independent Filmmakers Association, a diverse grouping where art, film, avant-garde and agitprop jostled. It was a kind of post-May 68 film culture. I encountered a cultural radicalism which displayed a critical engagement with film language, an attention to class and gender relations both on screen and behind the camera, and collective approaches to film production. The group around the Independent Filmmakers Association included figures like Mark Carlin, Peter Wallen and Laura Mulvey, and groups including the Amber Film Collective, Cinema Action, Four Corners, where I worked for some time. Out of this group came work which combined radical politics and aesthetics, pieces like Night Cleaners, So That You Can Live, Riddles of the Sphinx, I observed from the margins. For feminists at that time, women's participation was on the agenda. In film, this meant taking part in the film industry, getting your work and that by other women seen in autonomous groups if need be. At the intersection of the IFA and the Filmmakers Co-op, a group of women set up Circles, a distribution group for women's art, film and avant-garde work. A couple of years later, some of us interested in socialist and activist feminism founded Cinema of Women, Cow Films, and I spent my time carrying 16mm films to the station for dispatch to women's groups around the UK. Like a number of other women, I took on a technical role, becoming a sound recordist. To get my union card, I joined London Weekend Television as a trainee, the only woman in a department of 50. Around that time, I saw Chronicle of a Summer, and Les Maîtres Refus. It was some years later that I was able to see other films by Rouche. And my interest was always in making documentaries. But the ethics of social documentary were a problem to me. I didn't see what right I had to work with someone else's life story as my raw material. A version, I guess, of the personal is political slogan, which was very much out the way we thought at that time. More than any other figure, documentary figure, Rouche's attitude spoke to me. Not just his ethical position, his view also of film as a kind of research, with the camera a catalyst in that process. This idea that, not this kind of idea that life was there to be captured, but the idea that actually it was the unfolding in front of the camera which was interesting about film. Also his view of filmmaking as a collaborative activity which requires that the subjects are engaged as agents in the research inquiry of the film. Working as a sound recordist for much of the 80s only affirmed my discomfort with the standard arrangements within documentary production. A shoot in Zimbabwe in 1985 can stand as an exemplar of what seemed to me too often everyday ethical practice. So this was a film made by an NGO, or charity as we called it then, about women farmers. So it wasn't something for broadcast. I think I know what became of this piece of work, but anyway. We were working with a local woman farmer called Cecilia, who you can see dancing in this picture. I'm playing back some music that we recorded on a car journey, and she's enjoying it. The other people seem a bit unsure of what's going on in that situation. Anyway, so two anecdotes have stayed in my mind. The first, Cecilia was a farmer. She had a small house, very little in it, but she had a transistor radio. And I looked on with kind of astonishment as the director, an Oxbridge man, retuned the radio because he didn't think it was appropriate for her to be playing funk. And he wanted the music to be African music. So the casual imposition of his worldview on the situation stayed in my mind. On the same shoot, the director came to me one evening in distress because Cecilia was refusing to do any filming until she was given a cow. According to her, the researcher who'd come to see her first had said she'd get a cow. I had no idea what had been said. But what was interesting to me, deeply, was that she didn't know what the arrangement was. He didn't really know either. There wasn't any transparency. Something had been agreed, but it wasn't clear. And that seemed to me rather typical of what happens on documentaries, on social documentaries. So, in 1989, I did get a commission as a director to make a film with somebody I was working with closely there at that time, somebody called Vronware. We were doing some research on women and imperial history, and we pitched the idea and got a commission from Channel 4 to make a film for their Access TV slot, which was a kind of conversation with women who'd been in India under the Raj. Those much derided Memsahibs who were very much kind of in the subject of representation at that time. So the film was an intervention responding both to the representations of the white woman surfacing in a wave of nostalgic movies about the Raj, but also to the context of second wave feminism, where issues of race and empire were at best not regarded as a significant part of the story. So we invited, we researched, found some women who'd been in India and women of quite different class positions, and that was a very interesting part of the story, from an Anglo-Indian who spoke the local language, who was effectively a working class person in India, to people who were much more part of the kind of colonial elite. So we interviewed these women, we asked them to reflect on cultural representations of the Raj, the writings of John Masters and Edward Thompson, the movies that were now emerging, to think about colonialism, gender, class, through the lens of passing time and the emergence of feminism. We didn't hand the cameras to them. I don't think that film would have happened if we'd tried to. But the dialogic nature of the film, that invitation to them to consider, reflect, discuss, was a strategy to try and make a shared film project. After Hilda, I got opportunities to direct. I went to the BBC and worked on the nightly arts magazine programme, The Late Show, which is where I made that documentary about Rouge that I showed a clip from before. Making work about art and media, the deal with those taking part felt clear and simpler. With artist critics, there was a kind of equality. They had something to promote. I offered exposure and a critical commentary. They might or might not like what was said about the work, but they had a choice that they could make about their involvement. So, in 93, while at the BBC, I heard that the Community Programme Unit, the BBC's Access TV unit, was developing an initiative to reinvent the mass observation project with camcorders. Mass observation. Does everybody know about mass observation? Does anybody? Put up your hand if you know something about mass observation. Okay, really, really interesting project for those that don't. Just a fascinating project that began in 1939 when three men came together. Humphrey Jennings, a painter and poet, Charles Madge, a journalist, and Tom Harris, an anthropologist, recently back from Papua New Guinea. And the project came out of a dialogue in The New Statesman, where somebody made the observation that the kind of middle classes down south knew as little about the people in the north of England as we knew about the people in Papua New Guinea. Can't remember the quote exactly. And out of that conversation came the idea to make a study of England, a self-anthropology, as they began to call it. And there were two sides to this self-anthropology. On the one hand, there was something that seemed like anthropology as you recognise it. A group of young things went up and lived in Bolton for a while, and they observed the people, they observed everyday life. They took photographs and they sat in pubs and made notes about what people were saying. So actually quite bad anthropological practice, but it was a kind of anthropology. But then they did something else which was kind of really interesting, which was that they invited a group of people, quite diverse people, to write diaries about everyday life. And the place where Rouge and mass observation meet, as they kind of do, is around surrealism. So one of the things that was very interesting about mass observation was that Humphrey Jennings was very familiar with surrealism, had been part of the first surrealist exhibition in London. And so the things they invited people to write about were not the stuff of social realist documentary. They were things like dreams and, you know, observations, and as much about kind of unconscious and mechanisms as about conscious. So mass observation. I just go off and get a book about it. It's such an interesting project. So of course, I saw this notice that the BBC were thinking doing something related to mass observation and applied and became co-producer on the project with Chris Moore, the project which we then called Video Nation. So in the late 80s, the first wave of digital technology had offered the possibility of equipping members of the public and with camcorders. And the Community Programmes Unit had responded with a series called Video Diaries. The series, kind of 50-minute programmes within each, someone recorded during a period of their life when there was a big change or a kind of story unfolding. And you know, there's a running theme here about new technology and about documentary form, because, you know, at this moment, this new technology kind of, you know, brought lots of new things to the TV screen. This camcorder in the hand, with its characteristics of intimacy, embodied presence, the insider point of view, brought an immediacy to UK documentary, which at that time was dominated by rather tired, a relentless diet of fly-on-the-wall documentaries about observations of British institutions. So we were building on the video diary project, but this time the idea was to give those camcorders out to a large group of people. We found and trained 50 diverse people from the tribes living in the UK and invited them to film aspects of everyday life during the course of a year. We gave them training, cameras, and we devised a contract, which I really think was, I think it was the first time the BBC had a contract like this, where they had not a right to edit the material, because there were 50 of them and they were spread around the UK, but a contractual right of veto of the material, which meant that anything we wanted to do with that material, we edited the pieces, then we'd put them in the post, send them a VHS, and then have a conversation, and they had a right to say no for whatever reason, and in whatever, you know, whatever circumstances. And actually, I think that gave a really important bedrock of trust within the project. So I'll show you now one of... Okay, so an amazing thing about The Donation was that it was commissioned not in terms of, not as a series of programmes, but it was an open brief. We got, the commission was, okay, give 50 cameras out, give people training, see what material comes in. And we ended up making, and then we would pitch particular programmes when we could see there was a programme, a kind of emergent programme within that material. So we made programmes of all sorts of different shapes and sizes, but the programmes that most caught the public's eye, and in some ways I think expressed the project best, were these shorts that would show just before Newsnight, five nights a week. For 5 years they showed, just at 10:28. 2 minutes is short, but actually if you think about it, a 2 minute interruption to an evening of broadcasting, very often with one person's voice, was quite a substantial thing. Okay, so I'll show you a short. I'll show you, in fact, the first short that was ever broadcast in March 1994. And I'm going to say, we never again use music on these shorts, just to let you know. It makes me cringe. Anyway, but it doesn't matter. Let's stop. Okay.
N-I-R-R-O-R. Now, there was a time when I found they were very useful. They still are, of course, I have to use them. But it's a ghastly thing to look and see one's face, what it is now, and what you feel it should be inside. One doesn't feel old, you know. You get, I don't know what the age is, somewhere about 30 to 40. And from then on, inside, you don't get any older. But every time you look in that confounded mirror and see what time has done and age has done to your features, your body, your hands, everything, that's what I dislike more than anything.
So yeah, you can't show one, you have to show two at least, I think, so I'll find another one right away. But you know, I guess what was so interesting about this was, well, there are many things, but one of the things was that people surprised you all the time. If you're making a programme about beauty or ageing, Colonel Hedges is probably the last person you'd think to ask about it. And the fact that he takes the opportunity to talk about how he dislikes that process is just really kind of moving and interesting. And in fact, I think that was one of the first... So they'd do their recording, we'd give them some briefs, but open briefs. We kind of copied Mass Observation's methodology. So we'd give them these open briefs. After the training, we'd send them home. The first brief was, show us a favourite or a least favourite thing. And I can remember watching the VHS tape of that recording, and it was like, there was a mirror, and then there's Gordon Hedges saying that piece, and there isn't an edit in it, that's it. So that tended to be our response to the material, not about imposing a whole lot on it, but letting it breathe and looking for those places where it felt like people were in full flow communicating with the public, an imagined public. So just one more. This one hasn't got its title on for some reason.
In here is your power, and a lot of people respected me through my hair.
You can't believe it.
I can't believe it happened to me.
It doesn't mean anybody thinks really. Because I'm just, I'm doing it for myself, you see. I'm not doing it to please the crowds.
Come on, I'm not doing it inside cars.
We always categorize and put in a box, And my hair put me in a box. So I'm jumping out of that box now, and for a while people are going to have to find out which box I'm going to land down in again, because that's what they like to do, put you in boxes, so they know where you are.
Well, Dad, your dad's going to be so shocked. He's going to be on Monday. Everybody just can't wait to see everybody's faces.
Yeah? You're getting worried about it.
I'll say his face.
God, it feels a bit weird not having any hair around my head. I don't know when it is going out of the crazy house, man.
Oh, God. 96, so 10 years before YouTube. And I would say still at a time when on British TV, there was still a kind of, we were still at a point, it's hard to believe, where generally speaking, if you're going to interview a young black man, it's because you were going to do an item about unemployment or racial tension. So just the project, the fact that the project just made a space for people to do, to record what they wanted. And I think that kind of piece is so interesting to me, that the way he kind of balances that combination of personal and political, actually, that kind of commentary on people putting you in boxes. He's speaking about stereotyping, he's speaking about it, but he's also representing in a very tender way his family, the family relationship. And, you know, it's a celebration of their family life, I feel. So, you know, it's kind of, in a sense, it's his intervention, mediated by us. But again, I think there's little editing in that. I don't think you're going to find huge swathes of that on the cutting room floor, which was saying something completely different. You know, I think what we tried to do in the editing process was hear the kind of thrust of what people were communicating and reflect that in the editing. So we described Video Nation as self-anthropology. I think we took that from mass observation. I'm trying to remember where I am now. Okay. Here's some of the others. Self-anthropology, a phrase we took from mass observation. And I applied Roussian principles to their recordings. No music but that which emanates from the scene. That was the Petra thing, but even so, never again. Respect the pro-filmic event. That was Roush's term for that unfolding. You know, so the thing that makes film interesting, when you watch something unfolding, you know. So we'd let things unfold, uncut as much as possible. And I understood the process within a Roushian framework. The camera as catalyst, the participants performing, in a sense, their own lives. The pull of the camcorder's unblinking eye. So Roush had this notion of ciné-trance, ciné-trance, which obviously he took from kind of thinking about ritual. And the idea that when you were filming, you were kind of, you'd be lured into a kind of, you know, into a kind of dance with the camera. And I felt in a way there was something very interesting, which now we've seen a whole lot more of, about the way the camera invited and the way the people responded to that invitation. So we work closely with the participants. I feel like I know all these people. Mark McLean's daughter and Jean Lee. Oh dear, I've forgotten his name, and now he's died. And he lived in Bath in sheltered housing. But anyway, you know, I feel like I know these people. We work closely with them, we watch their rushes, and that felt like an intimacy. We were on the phone, we'd talk, we'd discuss. Something interesting about doing Video Nation, which was when I talked about it with peers in the industry, there would be this strange, to me, response, which was people would say, oh, Vicky Notion, I love those shorts, fantastic. And I'd say, yeah, it's really interesting, and we watch the brushes, and we do the training, and we da-da-da. And as I was saying this, they would kind of go, oh, okay. And actually, there was this response which was, that's inauthentic. The interest died because I think people thought these shorts just appeared in the post without any mediation whatsoever. And the idea that there was mediation sort of put people off. And I was troubled by this. Okay, I knew that there was a value in the collaboration, that bringing our professional skills together with the documentary material that they were recording made something happen that wouldn't have otherwise happened. The partnership between the BBC as an institution and the licence fee payers was enriched, this partnership enriched the BBC output for everyone and gave a more complex and full picture of life in the UK. And it was right at the end of the project that I came across the concept of co-creation, and that really kind of made sense to me of what I'd been doing. This seemed to be a descriptor which covered the collaborative dimension, meanwhile highlighting the fact that there is mediation, that there is more than one actor in this story. And it leaves open for question, what are the terms of the relationship? So so this is a quote from later on, but which I think describes the co-creative, points to something about co-creation which I think is important. The idea that it complicates this notion that participatory culture is the product of an autonomous relationship between the individual creator and the magic of technology, that technology would just make all this stuff happen. So final section. Documentary as open space. So now I'm thinking here about recent developments in documentary. It's going to take me 10 minutes. Do you think that's okay? Yeah, okay. Right. So, back in 2001, Lev Manovich wrote an important book, which maybe many of you have come across, The Language of New Media. And he was thinking about, he was asking himself, if cinema was the kind of paradigm of 20th century culture and affected everything around it, what was going to happen in 21st century culture if computerization was the paradigm? And he had this realization that the open aspect of computerization was going to be key. In that book, interestingly, he looked at one piece of work throughout and kept returning to it, and that piece of work was a documentary. Was Man with a Movie Camera, the luminous 1929 film, Ziga Vertov's film, which you should see. But he was suggesting that this openness would allow the potential for us to understand the world in new ways, and you know, in ways that were not available to that man with a movie camera back 100 years ago, when film was the media. So it's hard not to underestimate the transformative nature of this. Underestimate? Yes, that's right. We shouldn't underestimate the transformative nature of this openness, the impact of computerization on documentary. It's evident in all aspects of documentary production, from funding to rights to distribution to exhibition. So, crowdfunding, I won't dwell on it, but you know, crowdfunding is really significant. In 2012, the Kickstarter distributed more money than the National Endowment for the Arts in the States. Half of that money was for film, and a good part of that was for documentary. There's a good fit between documentary and crowdfunding, and some really interesting work, quality work, important work, political work has been made with support from Kickstarter and other crowdfunding platforms. One of the things that I think is very interesting is when you start seeing Creative Commons rights framework applied to documentary. This is just one amazing international collaborative project, Global Lives, where a group of people made 10 24-hour films about life in different parts of the world based on some demographic thinking about how you might represent humanity in 10 through 10 individual portraits. And the idea was to bring some of those stories back to the States, where international coverage is very poor. And this has had lots of unexpected effects, this project, in terms of the fact that the rights make the material available. So in Malawi, where there was there's very little material about the Chichewa language, it's becoming, the 24-hour recording is becoming the basis for a corpus for that language. So so I've talked about processes, but actually form, the way that computerisation has impacted documentary form is very substantial and important. And we can think about interactive documentaries, documentaries built with software for computers, documentaries as transforming the audience experience, because the audience becomes a participant, a co-creator in the process, not necessarily of the content, but these projects like the database documentary Journey to the End of Coal bring the audience into a dialogue with the interface. And there's a feedback loop. So actually this kind of a documentary like Journey to the End of Coal doesn't even exist until the audience member acts in relation to it. You choose, you click, you choose a path, and the story proceeds. So this is, yes, and some of those projects, kind of generative, living things which change and grow. And perhaps one of the most significant early examples of this was Jonathan Harris's 2005 We Feel Fine, a web-native documentary which drew in, and still does, samples the blogosphere every 5 minutes for the words fine and we feel fine, and then portrays them through a series of data visualizations, playful data visualizations. And this film of Jonathan, or film, this project of Jonathan Harris has, I think, really alerted people just how profoundly documentary might change as a web-based project. One of the significant changes for documentary, which is of great interest for documentary's social critical role, is participation in the content production itself, the way that that's been facilitated by cheap, accessible tools for content creation, video on your mobile, the web as an open platform for content sharing, exhibition, distribution. So each of these things, you know, the web in itself, mobile video in itself, would have been transformative to a documentary, but coming all at once, they're having a huge impact. So I'm going to zip through a couple of slides because I'm aware that I'm pushing it in terms of time. Check out High Rise, National Film Board of Canada production. It's been going on for 7 years, which addresses high-rise living around the world, where partnership is key to the project, partnership with a group of academics, with town planners, and with some high-rise dwellers who've been involved throughout the project. And these projects, you know, have that deep aspect in their kind of longitudinal quality. Or see Elaine McMillian's Hollow Project. Elaine went back to her childhood home in West Virginia to address rural poverty and depopulation, not by representing the people there as victims, but by making media with them to try and envision a different future. And here are some of the comments that some of those people made about taking part in that project. Still now with the rhetoric of universal participation, these quotes from Hollow participants, and there are a lot of them, they're just two, underline how people continue to feel that they can't get involved. The tools may be there for participation, but the confidence in editorial and the protocols of new platforms may not be there. So this kind of points to what Henry Jenkins calls the participation gap. And meanwhile, the context of the web that we were so optimistic about, perhaps utopian about, has shifted. The innately positive connotation of participation is thrown into question by corporate control of social media content, by tracking, targeted advertising, data mining. And on a more banal level, participation can amount in a project like Life in a Day to no more than harvesting free content from a large group of people. There were 80,000 contributions to that project, which the makers describe as an hour and a half of happiness, which I'm not sure perhaps everybody who took part would see the world today, you know, this world we live in as, you know, such a feel-good proposition. So we can invoke a poster from May 68, a poster actually which referred to the emergent interactive art of the time, questioning the power relations within participation. So I participate, you participate. I don't know if you all know French. They profit, I guess, is the punchline. So this new context demands some hard thinking about documentary participation online, and the need to develop a set of shared ethical protocols. John Dovey has discussed these twin features of collaboration and exploitation and thought about this issue of the extractive logic of the network and the problems for, you know, the challenge for documentary in that context. There are projects emerging like Do Not Trap, which look at those problems head on. It's an interactive project that launched this spring. It's worth a look. It proceeds in four chapters and draws in your material to show you the way your life online is being tracked and monetized. But I just want to end with two examples which I think suggest how one can think about the development of what one might call a participatory culture within documentary. The first is Kipu, a project which starts with the problem of forced sterilization of indigenous women and men in Peru in the 1990s. An issue which, despite those affected trying to go to court, has not been addressed by the government. A government which is likely to come back into power. And the people who initiated this project have done something very interesting, not making a film about the project, but working on the ethical issues of the project. And what the Kipu team have come up with is a kind of system, an analog to digital system, which could enable the women and men involved to ring a phone number or an analog phone to record their story and to hear the stories of other people. So they've kind of built a bridge between people who are living in remote areas without access to the internet. And that's the first stage of their project. And the second stage is going to be seeing how they can then kind of gather those stories together online and play them back, and so that people who are taking part understand who's hearing their story and what's happening to it. So it's kind of thinking about how you bridge that digital divide in a documentary project. The second and last example is a project called Question Bridge. Question Bridge Blackmails, which is a project about representing and redefining blackmail identity, an American project, which takes place in a space where representation and self-representation are at the heart of a problem being addressed. This project, made by a group of artists, picks up on the black educator and sociologist W.E.B. Du Bois' idea of double consciousness, that black American men suffer from this kind of being seen, reflecting back the kind of negative stereotypes that they see of them within the society. And it comes, and in order to address this issue, the filmmakers came up with a simple, ingenious strategy of devolving agency within the project by inviting those taking part to ask each other questions and then asking people to reply. So setting up what they call a video-mediated megalog. The project takes place as an installation, it's an online project, and crucially, it plays out as face-to-face dialogue between people in communities. I think there have been something like 30 events that they call blueprint roundtables in different towns and cities. They have an education project alongside. So the project is works at two levels. It functions to provide a stage for a dialogue within this diverse community, and is also to challenge preconceptions from people outside that diverse community. So I won't show a clip, but I'll tell you where you can find one later. So in conclusion, we can see the emergence of a variety of documentary participations produced in dialogue between documentary producers and publics, in interactions between users and interfaces, which reframe documentary as something open, dialogic, generative. And this kind of the way the scholars Patricia Zimmerman and Helen DeMichiel have talked about this as documentary as open space, drawing on that notion of horizontal, collaborative design, which the World Social Forum uses in its methodology. So this current of participation, I would suggest, was a current repressed within linear 20th century documentary models, now come into the fore. First articulated in the late 60s at a time of upheaval and social change, in our own era, when we face pressing challenges, among them growing inequality, environmental degradation, in the face of disaffection with traditional politics, we can see these expanded participatory documentaries as potential stages on which participants can enact identities as citizens rather than consumers, drawing attention to common concerns, challenging the status quo, arguing for and demanding alternative futures. But beyond the technological utopianism that in some ways marked the kind of early era of the web, we will now get the web that we make. So in conclusion, I would say that in each of these projects, we need to be asking, where is the participant's agency? How do they get to shape the project? Who gets what value from the project? Economic, cultural, reputational? And how might we move from participation to a participatory culture of documentary?